AI Unbound. I'm your host, Alka. Thank you for joining us today. It's a special day for us out here in the studio because this is the launch of our channel. You know, as we were thinking of a channel name, we thought of, say, AI Story, AI Speak. Didn't interest us. And then one day I was in the car and I just happened to listen to Eric Clapton's album, Unplugged. And then it struck me, just as his album is unplugged, our channel would be unbound. Unplugged because of the acoustic music and unbound because AI is limitless. It's boundless. So it's fair that I thank Mr. Clapton for this inspiration at the very start. And now I'm delighted to introduce Ramesh Raskar. He's from MIT Media Lab. Ramesh, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Alka. Great to be here.
So Ramesh has done a number of TED Talks. He is the recipient of Lemelson Prize, and he has many inventions that he has done. So Ramesh, you were going to tell us about your background. I bet it's interesting.
Thank you, Alka. It's great to be here. And I think I grew up in an environment where, you know, of course, we didn't have access to internet or mobile phones or even TVs. And, you know, we really lived on our imaginations. I mean, I remember, growing up, you know, at the age of 10 or 11 and thinking that the world only in front of me actually exists. And if I look behind me, there's actually nothing there, right? And many of us go through that feeling. But for me, I think it lasted well into high school. And if you think about today's virtual reality with a headset, that's exactly how it works. You know, the screen is just rendering what's in front of you. Wow. It's not rendering anything behind you. And as you turn your head, it starts moving things in front of you to create an illusion that you live in this reality. And so my PhD actually was in virtual reality and augmented reality and related techniques in computer vision and machine learning at UNC Chapel Hill. And after that, I worked in the industry for about 7 years. And I invented many, you know, new products in cameras and RFID and displays. And then about 2008, I joined as a faculty at MIT because what I realized is that when you're in the industry, you can invent in an area that everybody else understands.
Yes.
But at MIT, I wanted to go and create new areas altogether. So it has been really exciting to see, you know, kind of my childhood confusion about, you know, the world around us and the how we perceive it becoming my key research area now.
Wow.
Thinking about vision and computer graphics and machine learning.
That's awesome. So, you know, I was looking at a few things and I was really intrigued by the camera that can look around corners and beyond the line of sight. And how does that work?
Yeah, I know. Our passion is to, I run a group called Camera Culture.
Yes.
And our motto is to make the invisible visible inside our bodies, around us, and beyond. And so, yeah, we built a camera that can see around corners, beyond line of sight. And you're familiar with echoes of sound.
Yes.
You know, even if somebody's beyond line of sight, we can hear their sound. And that's because sound travels sufficiently slowly that our brains can process that audio because sound travels so slow. Light, on the other hand, travels very fast. Okay. So actually, even when things are around the corner, we are getting some light from those around the corner objects. It's just that, you know, things are happening at the speed of light. So we need detectors that are very, very fast. So the key idea that we developed in our group is, first, how do we create a camera that can see even light in slow motion, extremely fast? We call it, you know, kind of a trillion frame per second imaging. Femtophotography is just about 1 trillion frame per second. And with that camera, we can see light that's coming around the band. So to see around the corner, we shine light on the visible parts. Part of the light goes into the hidden area. Part of it comes to the visible part and back to the camera. And by analyzing these echoes of light, just like echoes of sound, we can decipher using some computational techniques to see around corners. So this has been exciting, and as I said, after I gave my TED Talk, you know, this whole field of femtophotography really went viral, and we also have a large DARPA program now, I believe around $28 to $30 million that's been set aside to build solutions to see around corners. So now there are many teams across the nation that are doing some wonderful, wonderful work, independent of my team now, to see around corners. And to me, this is like self-driving cars about 15, 20 years ago when DARPA had a challenge, if you remember, on about self-driving cars in urban as well as non-urban environments. And that DARPA challenge transformed into a whole industry of self-driving cars. And right now, DARPA has a challenge of seeing around corners, partially based on our work. And hopefully in the next 2-3 to 5 years, we'll see some amazing research and hopefully even commercial practical systems that can see around corners. We can have cameras in cars that can avoid collision of what's around the bend.
Yes.
Or firefighters can see people even if they can't see them directly in front of them. Or we can even build endoscopes that can see deep inside the body in different channels without having direct access to them. So maybe we can even replace x-rays by analyzing things with light.
Such useful applications. I mean, I'm intrigued. So many things it can do. I see you're also the co-founder of iNetra.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure you've built something there and you'd like to share it with us.
Yeah, again, it's about making invisible visible. And iNetra is something that started as a very small project in our group at MIT, where we can put a cell phone in a binocular, looks like a VR headset.
Mm-hmm.
You look through it, click on a few buttons, and gives you a prescription for your eyeglasses. Nearsightedness, farsightedness, and astigmatism, and can also optionally scan for your cataracts. And because such a low-cost solution, very portable, it can actually solve problems in this country where about 10% of school kids are left undiagnosed for their prescription, and because of they do poorly in school, when all they need is the right pair of glasses.
Oh.
So even in a country here, 10% of children are missing out. But globally, the problem is even worse. There are 2.6 billion people worldwide who need glasses but don't wear them. So we also spun out a venture out of it called iNetra.com and can provide solutions and sell eyeglasses. So this whole field of how can we make our vision, how can we make the tools for high quality vision accessible to the masses has been exciting outcome from that
so
effort.
This gives me a new definition of the word visionary, right? In
yeah.
two ways. Now you're making the invisible visible also.
Exactly.
So I know AI for health is another area which is very close to your heart.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering if you have, what you think about the patient data privacy issues or any concerns about
I think that's such a good question, Alka, because, when we talk about making invisible visible, it's not just about being able to see around corners to make what's invisible visible, or building medical devices to what's invisible, again, visible, but it's also the invisible data. And I would say that, the biggest challenge in AI today is the siloing of data. Because the data is stuck in silos, we're not able to make sufficient progress using AI in industry like health. So we're very focused on that problem now in our group at MIT. And we think there are three main challenges we need to solve to make the invisible visible. The first problem is, how do we make it easy enough for people to actually participate in the AI revolution? And we're solving that with a technique called automating machine learning. The second is, how do we take these data silos and actually allow many hospitals, pharma companies, pharmacies, governments, and nonprofits to actually come to a data commons? But not just do that because this is good for society or it's something they should do for research, but actually it's a technique that we have invented that allows you to do AI on private data, which means that without sharing the raw patient data, you can still perform AI. And it's a notion of a decentralized AI. You know about decentralized ledger,
yes,
which created blockchain and unleashing a revolution in distributed computing. We're talking about decentralized AI, which is going to unleash the ability of AI to work on this very siloed data in a very decentralized manner. So the split learning or split AI allows us to work on very siloed data. And the third piece is, even if people want to share data, why would they do it? there needs to be incentives.
Yes.
So what about a data market where, you know, individuals or hospitals or even population groups can barter and they can actually get dollars for their health data? And if we can do that, then the data will truly become liquid. People will not hoard data, but data will become liquid. And with the liquidity of data, I think it will start flowing into the system and again, allow AI in health. So by solving these three main problems, automating ML to overcome the challenges of participating AI, split AI, which is dealing with siloed data, and then data markets to bring liquidity to that data is what we're working on in AI for Health.
Wonderful. I did read up on split learning and I really found it fascinating where how some portion of the processing is done at the hospital and the later part is done at the server. I was really fascinated. And the other thing you say is that this data will be then easily available to smaller organizations.
That's
so
right.
They will not be left behind, only the large, as opposed to the large organizations.
Exactly.
Okay, so you have already built a camera that looks around the corner. Now let Ramesh Raskar look beyond the horizon and tell us what he sees in the next 5 years happening in the AI domain.
That's fascinating. I mean, you know, as I said, split learning is a method that will truly unleash this decentralized AI. And, you know, I think right now we have a potential challenge where, you know, large technology companies or governments are hoarding the data and using it for themselves. And it makes it difficult for a new player, a new innovator to participate because they don't have access to data. And when it comes to health, you can imagine, you know, just achieving health parity and equality and inclusiveness is a massive challenge. So how are you going to unleash these innovators to go and solve problems in drug discovery or population health or precision health and wellness? And all these factors, I think we need, you know, a lot of talented young innovators to jump in. So we think something like split AI will actually create an ability for many players to actually work together. And this is like encryption, you know, 50 years ago, yeah. Where, you know, only large banks could authenticate you based on your face and your signature. And that created a barrier for other people to participate in that economy. But because of encryption, now any small player can participate and we can work across, you know, online or the internet, and encryption really, you know, allows us to do all kinds of commerce. Similarly, split AI will allow you to new kind of commerce. So let's think, as you said, 4 to 5 years ahead on this notion of if everybody can talk to everybody else and perform AI and machine learning in an automated manner, and there's a dollar value associated with data, how will this world look like? I want to use the analogy of energy grids. Okay. Now, you probably have rooftop solar. And rooftop solar does a very good job of participating in the energy grid where, you know, the rooftop solar in real time can calculate how much it should get paid by the energy grid for exchanging 1 kilowatt of power. And these bots, tiny programs that are running in, you know, in energy companies, in your rooftop solar and your storage devices, and so energy storage devices, the small bots are doing all these transactions in real time. Mm-hmm. If you think about the financial grid, it's the same thing. There are all these small bots that are running on Wall Street and all over the place doing the trading and making this you know, a very data efficient system. Can we do something similar for health? Can we create a health grid where these tiny bots running on your Fitbit, running on your watch, running on a CT scan, running on an X-ray scan, running in a hospital, running in a population health center, running at CDC, running at, you know, WHO, all these tiny bots could be talking to each other, doing automated machine learning, doing machine learning without exchanging raw data, but using so-called smash data, split learning, and even getting paid for doing all those transactions. So I could imagine a health grid, you know, just a few years from now where it's not just the regulatory forces, but the market forces and the need of an individual, which is behavioral forces. The behavioral forces and the market forces could actually allow a health grid to function. And of course, there'll be some reason for us to be careful about the ethics and biases and inclusiveness, yes. But you know, we are very concerned about that as well. But in the big scheme of things, I think a notion of a health grid can totally transform the cost and efficiency and efficacy of our health solution. So I like to call it kind of a God's eye view on a health system. And I don't want to use the God's eye view in any religious connotation, but if you're a video game player, you know a God's eye view is what you need when you're playing a video game. Or if you use Google Maps, then Google Maps gives you also this God's eye view of not just where you are, but where everybody else is. And the reds and the greens on the map tell you what you should do next. And I think we need a similarly Google Maps for health, because the health data, if it's really transparent, really liquid, will give us this view on what where it can be useful, it's useful to who, how do we exploit it without sharing raw data, how much people should get paid for it, depending on the quality of the data, depending on its need, depending on its market forces, and so on. And having this God's eye view on a health grid can completely transform the way we think about healthcare and wellness and research and pharmaceuticals as we go forward.
Absolutely, it's sounding so, so interesting. So I know you write a lot of papers as well. What are the things you do if you have any spare time? What's your hobby? What do you do?
I'm just so excited about creating this health grid and making the invisible visible. A lot of my hobbies nowadays is to, you know, call up some really influential people and take them out for a dinner or a drink and just pick their brains, because I feel like there are so many people who are very excited about solving, you know, the big challenges of healthcare in this country and also globally, but so far they didn't have a means, a mechanism to actually make an impact. But I'm very grateful for their time, and I think the work we are doing at MIT and a lot of our collaborators all over the world are very passionate about solving health grid. So in my spare time, I do like to kind of, you know, just socialize with these people. And of course, I love spending time with my family and my two daughters, and I'm teaching them, you know, how to bike.
Oh, wow, wonderful. Ramesh, thank you so much for your time. And I hope you come back so that our learning, our deep learning can continue.
Yes, I think, you know, Alka, I think, you know, AI right now is plugged in, but we want to make it unplugged.
Absolutely.
And I think the challenges around health are vast, yeah. But we need to unbound them, I think.
Oh, wow.
And I think, you know, the opportunities in AI, especially for health, are just so amazing that we just have to try. And it's not going to be easy, but it's not impossible.
Absolutely. I would like to thank my audience for joining us today. And also, last not the least, a huge thanks to the production team that will be putting it all together for us. Thank you.